Good morning, students. In the 7th lecture of BSc 2 semester 3 paper 5 physical chemistry, we have seen the experimental procedure of conductometric titration, and this is the schematic representation of measurement of conductance with the help of conductometer. The apparatus consists of, this is the conductometer, and the solution under study in which we have dipped the conductivity cell, and from the burette we add usually NaOH solution in the acid base titration, and in this beaker we take acid solution. And we have seen there are four types of acid base titrations. Here conductometric titrations are the titrations in which we determine end points of titration by measurement of conductance, and the principle of conductometric titration is that conductance depends on concentration of the ions in the solution and velocity of the ions, and due to this, as the number of ions in the solution decreases or increases, conductance varies with the addition of titrant in the solution. Then we have seen the nature of the graph in case of HCl and NaOH titration. Here at first conductance decreases with addition of NaOH up to end point of the titration, and then again conductance values goes on increasing. This is the graph which shows variation of conductance with volume of alkali added. Then this is the same graph. Here in case of weak acid, acetic acid, and strong base as a NaOH, this is the nature of the graph. The conductance values, they steadily increases up to the equivalence point, and then there is a sharp increase in the conductance values due to excess OH minus ions. Then the third type, here it is the titration of strong acid and weak base. Suppose for example we have weak base, it is the NH4OH, and strong acid as the HCl, and due to addition of NH4OH, the conductance values of HCl decreases up to the equivalence point, and then there is a steady, or it remains same with addition of NH4OH. Then we have seen the advantages of conductometric titration. Conductometric titrations, they do not require indicators. The colored solutions we can titrate easily. Then these titrations are suitable for colored solutions. Endpoint is determined by graphical means, so we get correct results or accurate results. And we can use this method for the analysis of turbid solutions or suspensions or very weak acids, weak bases, and mixture of weak and strong acids. These are titrated with the help of conductometric titrations. Then we have seen the determination of transport number, and here the fraction of current carried by the ion, it is the transport number of cation, it is represented by T plus, and transport number of anion, it is represented by T minus. We have seen the moving boundary method for determination of transport number. The principle of this method, if the velocities of positive and negative ions under the influence of an applied electric field are measured accurately by the observation of moving boundary, then the transport numbers of these ions can be determined. That means the simple principle used here, we have to observe the velocities of positive ion under the influence of electric field. Then the schematic representation of moving boundary method. It consists of dumbbell shaped vertical glass tube. At the top there is a platinum neutral metal. It acts as a cathode. At the bottom there is a anode and it is of cadmium metal, and these two electrodes are connected to each other through coulometer. Here it is a rheostat, here it is a battery, and CdCl2, it is a indicator, it is a indicator electrolyte we used, and principal electrolyte here it is HCl solution. HCl solution is poured through this hole above the CdCl2 solution. When we complete this circuit and pass the current, the boundary it get migrated towards the cathode. That means the H plus ions of the HCl solution and Cd plus plus ions of the CdCl2 solution, they get transferred towards the cathode, and hence we observe the moving boundary. Then we have seen the calculations, and by using this formula, transport number of H plus ion, it is equal to 96500 into L into A into C divided by 1000 into Q, where L it is the length of the moving boundary moved towards cathode, A it is the cross sectional area, C it is the concentration of the solution, and Q is the quantity of electricity electricity flown. Then if we have passed the current in amperes for time t, then this Q is replaced by the product I into t, and by using this equation we can determine the transport number of H plus ion. Then the factors influencing transport number, we have seen the first factor, it is the nature of electrolyte. You know the transport number of cation, it depends on transport number of anion and vice versa. We have seen this. Then the second factor, concentration of electrolyte, then temperature, complex formation, abnormal transport number, and degree of ions. We have seen in detail all these points. Then let us see one example how to determine the transport number of cation and anion by using the moving boundary method. Suppose this is our problem. Calculate transport numbers of H plus and Cl minus ion from the following data obtained by moving boundary method. And we have given concentration of HCl solution, it is equal to 0.1 normal. Weight of Hg deposited in coulometer, it is equal to 0.12 grams. Movement of boundary moved towards cathode, and that length L, it is equal to 7.5 centimeter. And cross-sectional area of the tube, it is equal to 1.25 centimeter square. This is the problem, and these are the given quantity, and the solution of this problem, we know that we can determine the transport number of H plus ion by using this formula, and it is equal to 96500 into L into A into C divided by 1000 into Q, where Q, it is the quantity of electricity, and it is equal to I into T, where I, it is the current strength in amperes, and T, it is the time for which we pass the current. Then we know that equivalent weight, it is the product of Faraday's constant, that means 96500 coulombs into electrochemical equivalent, and here the weight of silver deposited in coulometer. That means this equivalent weight of silver, it is equal to 108, and it is equal to 96500 into Z, where Z it is the electrochemical equivalent. Therefore, we can find the electrochemical equivalent. It is equal to 108 divided by 96500. By using this equation, we can find the electrochemical equivalent. I repeat once again, the equivalent weight, it is the product of 96500 into electrochemical equivalent. That is, the equivalent weight of silver, it is equal to 108, and it is equal to 96500 into Z. Therefore, Z, it is equal to 108 divided by 96500. Then we know that the weight that is deposited in the coulometer, it is equal to Z into I into T, and it is given as 0.12 gram, and so it is equal to 108 divided by 96500 into I into T. Therefore, from this equation, we can write I into T, it is equal to 0.12 into 96500 upon 108. Then substituting these values in the above equation, we get transport number of H plus ions, it is equal to 7.5 into 1.25 into 0.1 into 96500 into 108 upon 1000 into 0.12 into 96500, and this becomes as 0.8437. This is the transport number of H plus ion, and the transport number of Cl minus ion, it is determined by subtracting this value from 1. That is, transport number of Cl minus ion, it is equal to 1 minus 0.8437, and it becomes equal to 0.1563. This is the value of transport number of Cl minus ion. Remember that the sum of transport number of H plus ion and transport number of Cl minus ion, it is always 1. That means when we add these two values, we get it, the sum, it is equal to 1. And thus we can calculate, we can determine the transport number of H plus ion and Cl minus ion by having the data from moving boundary method. You can use the another problems for your practice. This is the moving boundary method, and remember, this method is a very simple and easy to understand, and in the exam there may be problems based on this method. Then let us start with the next lecture, lecture number 8 on Monday, 24 August 2020, at the time 11:45 to 12:15. And this is the BSc 2 semester 3, again paper 5. And the last point in the chapter here, the advantages of conductometric titration. We repeat once again. Here, the advantages of conductometric titrations. Colored solutions like KMnO4, K2CR2O7, CuSO4, etc., which cannot be titrated by ordinary indicator method, can be successfully titrated by this method involving conductivity measurement method. Then second advantage, this method can be used for very dilute solutions like 0.1 normal, 0.01 normal, 0.001 normal solutions, as well as for weak acids and weak bases, etc. then more accurate results are obtained in such titrations because endpoints are determined graphically, that is, by plotting the values of conductance against volume of alkali added from the burette. Then this method is useful for the determination of endpoints of the titrations in which precipitation takes place. For example, titration of KCl versus AgNO3. The reaction taking place in between KCl and AgNO3 we can write as KCl plus AgNO3. It gives AgCl. It gets precipitated in the form of 5PPT plus we have KNO3. Then the conductometric titrations are used for the titration of mixture of weak acid and strong bases, and we can determine the normalities of weak acid as well as strong acids simultaneously. And the last advantage here, endpoint in these titrations, it is the intersection of two lines so that no extra care is needed near the endpoint of the titration. These are the some advantages of conductometric titrations. Then our last point of this chapter, it is the migration of ions, Hittorf's rule and transference number or transport number. You know, ions exist independently in the solutions and electricity is carried through the solution of an electrolyte by the migration of ions when electric current is passed through the solution. Ions move in the opposite directions towards the oppositely charged electrodes and usually at a different rates or speed. The rates or velocities of ions vary considerably or changes considerably because of differences in size, then degree of hydration and the charge. Then, you know, the process of electrolysis, that is the migration of ions. Suppose this is a cell, it consists of anode, that is positive electrode, cathode, that is negative electrode we have, and this is the solution. Suppose that solution is NaCl solution, and these two electrodes are connected through battery. As we complete the circuit, that means the current flows in this solution, the electrolysis takes place, and electrolysis is nothing but migration of ions towards the respective electrode. Here the Na plus ions, they get migrated towards Cl cathode. Na plus ions, they get migrated towards cathode, and Cl minus ions, they get migrated towards anode. This is the migration of ions. And at first, Hittorf shown that or investigated that each ion, it migrate towards respective electrode with different velocities. That means independent migration of ions takes place in the solution. And he formulated his law as Hittorf's law or Hittorf's rule. Then suppose this is a big electrolytic cell. It consists of anode A, then here it is a cathode, and this anode and cathode, they are separated by these two diaphragms. Suppose A, it is our one diaphragm, and B, it is our another diaphragm, so that we have this anode compartment, this one is middle compartment, and this one is cathode compartment. This is the हिटॉर्फ सेल और इलेक्ट्रोलाइटिक सेल ही यूज्ड फॉर द स्टडी ऑफ इंडिपेंडेंट माइग्रेशन ऑफ आयन्स एंड आयन्स मूव विथ डिफरेंट स्पीड्स. इट इज फर्स्ट शोन बाय द साइंटिस्ट हिटॉर्फ. लेट इनिशियली वी हैव फोर मॉलिक्यूल्स इन ईच कंपार्टमेंट. दैट मीन्स फोर पॉजिटिव आयन्स, फोर नेगेटिव आयन्स. हियर ऑल्सो इन द मिडल कंपार्टमेंट वी हैव फोर कैटायन्स, फोर एनियन्स. एंड द फर्स्ट सिचुएशन, सपोज ओनली एनियन्स आर एबल टू मूव, देन व्हाट हैपन्स फ्रॉम दिस कैथोड कंपार्टमेंट टू एनियन्स, दे गेट माइग्रेटेड टूवर्ड्स द पॉजिटिव इलेक्ट्रोड, दैट मीन्स एनोड कंपार्टमेंट. एंड द रिमेनिंग टू कैटायन्स दे रिमेन विदाउट पार्टनर, दे आर सपोज्ड टू बी डिस्चार्ज्ड. And the situation, it is like this. Here, when the anions are able to move, in this case, the discharge of two negative ions at the anode and two positive ions at the cathode takes place. Then, suppose in the second situation, cations and anions, they migrate with the same speed. And if two cations and two anions, they get migrated towards respective electrode, here the situation, it is like this. In this case, four anions and four cations, they get discharged at the respective electrode. And suppose in the third case, anions, they travels twice the speed of cation. In this case, when two anions, they get migrated towards the anode, only one cation, it will migrate towards the cathode. And we will see here that the discharge of ions takes place in the same amount. That means three anions, they get discharged, and here three cations, they get discharged. And from the above considerations or from the above experiment, it can be concluded that ions are always discharged in equivalent amounts. Concentration of the solution in the middle compartment remains the same, that is, no change in concentration takes place at the middle compartment, and loss of concentration around any electrode is proportional to the speed of the ion moving away from that electrode. Then the Hittorf related all these considerations in the form of Hittorf's rule, and he formulated his rule in the form of equation, and this equation is known as Hittorf's rule. The fall in concentration around anode divided by fall in concentration around cathode, it is equal to speed of the cation, that is U plus, upon speed of the anion, that is U minus. And the important assumption is made by Hittorf, that is the discharge of ions. Here the discharged ions do not react with the electrode material. While performing the experiment, Hittorf made one assumption, and that assumption is that the discharged ions do not react with the electrode material. Otherwise, instead of decrease in concentration, an increase in concentration occurs around the electrode. Here, in the Hittorf's experiment, the concentration change takes place only in the anode compartment and cathode compartment. There is no increase in concentration, and if the ions, they react with the electrode material, under this condition there is increase in concentration takes place. And here is the end of your chapter. Next time we will see the examples related with the all formulas that are involved in this chapter. Thank you. दादिया ले बेकार पूर्व